Good morning. Let's stand on a Mother's Day and sing, "I pledge allegiance to the Lamb."
Together to get started. Father God, we come to you on this day to worship you. And Lord, it just happens to be Mother's Day, Lord. We thank you right now for the women of our life, God, the women that have taken time to invest in us, to give us life guidance, to move us from where we are. And Lord, especially the godly women in our life who point to you. And Father, I thank you today for every mom here. And Lord, I pray for the blessing in those homes, God. I pray, Lord, that today we learn something and they get some conviction about what they ought to be doing. But more than that, Lord, some praise and some honor and some glory, God. We are so grateful, Lord, for godly moms. So I thank you today that we can come here, celebrate this day together, and Lord, worship you because you have given us this wonderful gift. So I pray today, Lord, that we'll listen for your words, and Lord God, we'll follow your spirit. God, when you touch us, that we will pay attention. So Lord, we give you this day, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You be seated. That is appropriate on Mother's Day, is it not? All right. I wish everybody came to church with that much enthusiasm. Good morning. Good to see you in Pickensville today. I pray that you have just a wonderful day of worship with us. I do want to encourage you to come on Wednesday nights. We're studying through the book of Ephesians. We start at 6:30 with a meal. It's actually catered. First Sunday we do potluck. You missed that this past week. It was fabulous. But then we do catered every week. So if you'd like to join up, you can sign there. But if you just want to come to the Bible study, we do that at 7. So I just encourage you in that every week. So I hope that you'll join us for that. That's all the only announcement that I have this morning. I am so grateful for Mother's Day. I know I had a wonderful, fun mother. It was just great to grow up with Linda Jones, okay? She was a mess. I told somebody the other day, she's done everything. She sang in gospel quartet. She was the witch at the witch at Halloween at our school. I mean, she was just so much fun, and she is in glory right now, and I just thank God for her. Praying moms, part of the reason I stand right here today. So moms, I salute you. I salute you. We like to recognize birthdays. Anybody had a birthday since the last time we met? I'm a grandson. Yeah. Somebody else up here. You know, yeah, help her down. Oh. Oh, okay. Scotty. Yeah, I see you. Hey, let's stand up. We're going to say happy birthday to him.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
So you went with gray hair color this time, right? It was purple last week. I guess the birthday is still a little purple, all right? And Scott, you went with what you got. All right.
All right.
Hey, bless you for being here today. It's Hey Y'all time. Turn around, smile at somebody, wave at them, tell them good morning.
Thank you.
do have one more announcement. Tim don't know a whole lot about it. He knows a little bit about it. But 21st of May, on Saturday night, we're going to have a steak cooking here at the church, okay? 6:30. And we're going to have a little gospel bluegrass band playing for us, and we're going to have a steak cooking. 30 years, guys. They've been here for 30 years. So that's pretty awesome. We've been blessed at this church to have such. Yes. So anyway, going to be a sign-up sheet up here. Miss Stacy will have it after church. $12, guys. Where are you going to go get steak, salad, and potato, and good music for $12, okay? And what's that? Oh, he might. I don't know.
I'll buy your
Do that so we know how many steaks to get, okay? So let's sign up for that. All right, let's continue our worship. Living for Jesus. Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do, yielding allegiance,
as in heaven, so on earth. My heart is drawn to self-exalting. Help me seek your kingdom first. As Jesus walked, so I shall walk, held by your same unchanging love. Be still my soul, oh, voice and praise. Father, not my will, but yours be done. How in that garden he persisted, I may never fully know the fearful weight of true obedience. It was held by him alone. What wondrous faith to bear that cross, to bear my sin. What wondrous love. My hope was sure when there my Savior prayed, Father, not my will, but yours be done. When I am lost, when I am broken, in the night of fear and doubt, still I will trust in my good Father. Yes, to one great King I bow. As Jesus rose, so I shall rise, and ransom glory at the throne. My heart restored, with all your saints I sing, Father, not my will, but yours be done. As we go forth, our God and Father, lead us daily in the fight, that all the world might see your glory and your name be lifted high. And in this name we overcome, for you shall see us safely home. Now as your church we lift our voice and pray, Father, not my will, but yours be done. Father, not my will, but yours be done. Father, not my will, but yours be done.
Haley always does such a great job. That's my daughter-in-law, by the way. All right. Celebrating her first Mother's Day. We got both the grandbabies in our house this week, and we actually got some sleep last night, if you can believe it. All three of them. I forgot. The grand girls. I forget to mention. Jim, I'm sorry, buddy. All right. Okay. Happy Mother's Day. I got a few things to help us kind of get in the mood for this, okay? Please forgive me if you think they're corny, but I got us some memes. Let's roll through them real quick. We didn't go through them together, but so here's the first thing. Moms are like, thank the Lord it's bedtime. Amen? Mom, I remember that from last night. Every time in our house when it gets close to bedtime, it's always good to get. Let's go on, okay? Number two, I don't want to sleep like a baby. I just want to sleep like my husband. I got up this morning and said, wow, Dolly slept through the night last night. Stacy says, you got up and changed her diaper. That's a true story. Anyway, number three, let's show another one. Am I a good mother, Susan? My name's Amy. Mamas, you ever had those kind of days? Go to the next one. We're going to go through a few more. The first time that you hear mom, the 7,567th time you hear mom. Amen. It's the difference. Go. I thought that was good. Mama Lisa. Go to the next one. Finally, when a new mom asked me if motherhood will get easier. Oh, well, God, honey, no. Okay? Got a couple more, I think. when your kids are all losing their minds at the same time and you got to connect with Jesus so you don't do anything stupid, all right? And then I found this, and I found this interesting because I've seen this play out. Everything that moms do, but if the dad ever does it, he's like the superhero. Have you ever noticed that? All right, let me just show you a couple of them, okay? Number one is the fun dad, because he brought home from fast food. If mom does that, she's called a lazy mom, okay? Number two, you got a dad who is present. In other words, he's with that child. But mom's with the child. She's on her phone. She's just inattentive, okay? Number three, some of these not as funny. They're kind of serious, all right? All right, he's such a good dad. She's just a run-of-the-mill mom. That's what moms are supposed to do. And this last one, I like this one. No, that's not it. Involved dad, he's dropping the kid off at school. Well, that's what working mom, just a different in attitude. One last one, okay? And this is a super helpful dad. That's just mom. That's what she does every day. Moms, you are super moms. That's the way I feel about that. So I want to talk to you today about Mother's Day, and we're going to actually deal with the passion of Miss Zebedee. Now, I call her that because I don't know her last name, okay? We're going to go to Matthew chapter 20 and then verses 20 through 23 in just a moment, okay? Motherhood is an interesting dynamic. It really is. Children can be such a blessing, and they can be such a pain in the rear, okay? Let's just be honest. And it is that. I heard about a grandmother who's putting her little grandson to bed one night. It was on the eve of his birthday, and he was 4 years old. He's going to be five. She's trying to get him to grasp that idea, and she says, you know, honey, how you've been holding up the four fingers all year, right? You four fingers. Well, guess what? You're going to go to bed a four-year-old, but when you wake up tomorrow, you're going to be five. And what does that mean? You get to add your thumb. And he looked at, he says, wow, tomorrow I'm going to be a handful, okay? Well, Jim turned 10 Friday. So, Jim, you are a double handful, okay? You're a double handful. But if you know all this, mothers, they're teachers. Mothers are disciplinarians. They're cleaning ladies. Some of moms are gardeners and mowers of grass, nurses, doctors, chauffeurs, counselors. Moms are developers of personalities. They are molders of vocabularies. They are shapers of attitudes. Moms are soft voices saying, I love you, and loud voices guiding people in the way that they should live. I've always felt this way, that mothers are a link to God. They are a child's first impression of God's love. That sacrificial love, that love that I can't even know as a man. There's a link there with motherhood. And mothers are all of these things and so much, so much more, okay? I know by this time you have read Emma Bombeck's writings where she writes about when God was creating mothers. I'm going to read it to you. I don't care if you've heard it before. This is my pulpit. I'm going to read it to you again because I want you to grasp what was going on here, and certainly God does not need help and none of this surprises him, but she says on the day that God created mothers that he had already worked a long day of overtime, and the angel said to him, said, Lord, you know, you sure are spending a lot of time with this one. And I'm going to pick up her writing, okay? The Lord turned and said, have you read the specs on this model? She is supposed to be completely washable but not plastic. She is to have 180 moving parts and all of them replaceable. She is to have a kiss that will heal everything from a broken leg to a broken heart. She's to have a lap that will disappear whenever she stands up. She's able to function on black coffee and leftovers. She's supposed to have six pairs of hands. Six pairs of hands, the angel asked. That's impossible. It's not the six pairs of hands that bothers me. It's these three pairs of eyes. She's supposed to have one pair that sees through closed doors. So whenever she asks, what are your kids doing in there? She already knows what the kids are doing in there. And she has another set in the back of her head that she sees all things that she's not supposed to see, but she must see. And then she has one pair right in the front where she can look at that child that just goofed up and communicate love and understanding without saying a word. That's too much, the angel said. You can't put that much in one model. Why don't you rest for a while and resume your creating tomorrow? He said, no, I can't. I'm close to creating someone very much like myself. I've already come up with a model who can heal herself when she is sick, who can feed a family of six with 1 pound of hamburger, and who can persuade a 9-year-old to take a shower. Then the angel looked at the model of motherhood a little more closely and said, She's too soft. Oh, but she's tough, said the Lord. You'd be surprised at how much this mother can do. Can't she think? Asked the angel. Not only can she think, said the Lord, but she can reason and compromise and persuade. Then the angel reached over and touched her cheek. And he said, this one's got a leak. I told you couldn't put that much into one model. And the Lord said, that's not a leak, that's a tear. What's the tear for? Asked the angel. He said, well, it's for joy, it's for sadness, it's for sorrow, it's for disappointment, it's for pride. And the angel said, you are a genius. And the Lord said, oh, I didn't put the tear there. I didn't put the tear there. I wanted to read all of that story again, for those of you who already heard it, because I wanted us to kind of get the feel of what Miss Zebedee is dealing with here. Miss Zebedee, she's a mom, so she is totally invested in these kids of hers, and it comes through. Maybe we can understand Miss Zebedee. She is the mother of James and John. James and John, two of the high-ranking disciples of the Lord. I want to read about an encounter with her, and many times this encounter is looked at negatively, but I want to show you some positive stuff out of it. Matthew chapter 20, verse 20. Then the mother of Zebedee came to Jesus, the mother of the sons of Zebedee came to Jesus with her sons, bowing down and making a request of him. And he said to her, what do you wish? And she said to him, command that in your kingdom these two sons of mine may sit one on your right and one on your left. But Jesus answered, you do not know what you're asking. Are you able to drink of the cup that I'm about to drink? And they said to him, we are. They totally didn't get it. And he said to them, my cup you shall drink, but to sit on my right and on my left, this is not mine to give, but for those whom it has been prepared by my Father. As I went back over my notes this morning, I should have made a point number one for my intro, and that is this, that Miss Z is a follower of Jesus Christ. If you want to write that one up there, you can. It's not even in the notes. Don't try to scroll to them. But here is Miss Zebedee, and she comes to the Lord. She is close enough to the Lord to approach him and ask this kind of question. So she is obviously close to the situation. The situation being that the Messiah is here, her sons are following, but there's another thing, and that is that she is keenly aware of his words and keenly aware of the teachings about his kingdom. Because she comes to him and says, I know you got a kingdom coming, and I want to talk to you about it. So she's close to the situation, she's close to the Lord, and her two sons are two-thirds of the inner circle. Peter, James, and John, they're always listed as the first three. They're always there together. They're the ones that go up on the mountain. They're the ones that are always first in the list. So she is certain that when the Lord forms his kingdom, that it will be like any other kingdom. And there will be positions and ranks, and there will be generals, if you will. There will be secretaries of state. There will be a setup. And she says, I want my sons to be a part of that. There will be a rank of responsibility and of authority. But then, in the first part of this chapter, she is around to hear Jesus when he goes and he teaches. He gives this parable. And it disrupted her a little bit. Because she's seen her two boys, and they're hanging out with Jesus all the time. They're at the top of the list. She is very proud. They made the dean's list. They made the president's list. But all of a sudden, she hears this story about a landowner. You can go back and read it. It's the first part of this. And this landowner goes out. He needs some help. So he goes out in the morning, and he hires these workers. They would go out and they stood on a street corner somewhere and people would drive by and pick them up. And they came, they agreed on a wage. And he says, great, I need work. You need money. So they go to work for him. Obviously, things are not going as quickly as he'd like because he goes back in the middle of the day and he gets more workers and brings them in. He says, I will give you a fair pay. And they say, okay. He goes back later in the afternoon with just a little bit of time left in the day. He gets more workers and he brings those workers. And then just to cut to the chase, at the end of the day, he pays them all the same. Some of them started in the morning. Some of them started very close to the end of the day, but he paid everybody the same. Mama Zebedee says, wait a minute. My boys have been morning workers. They've been here from the beginning. They've invested their whole life. They dropped their nets. They dropped everything that they had. They've been following. So it concerned her. She began to question this. And she says, will my children have the seats in the kingdom that is to come? So when the opportunity presents itself, she comes there. Now, I want you to notice that Matthew says that she bowed before him. So sometimes when we read this story, we think, look at this pushy mama. I don't get that feeling, do you? I think it's a mom who's interested. She's around a lot. She knows the Lord herself, and she's interested in the welfare of her boys. So when the opportunity came, she reverently, there's a reverence here, bowed down and says, Lord, when you establish your kingdom, I have a request. I would like, because Jesus asked her, what do you want? She says, I would like for my boys, one to sit on the right, one to sit on the left. And it'd be easy to criticize her and say, well, she was very presumptuous to even think that they might get these seats. But that is not the way I feel, especially on Mother's Day. I want to pull out some positive things. I want us to capture her passion. There is not a mom in this room that wouldn't have done what she did. A good mom, let's put it that way. There are some bad moms, let's be honest. A good mom wouldn't have given an opportunity. You know the Lord, you know the, you know, and you get an opportunity. Your son works at a big corporation. You used to teach the boss in Sunday school when he was a little boy, and you sit down at a table together one night and you say, hey, you think my son will ever get a job promotion? You know, it's kind of like that. So she says to him, she says, and I want you to notice this. While Jesus didn't say, yep, they can have seats, he didn't deny it either. Did you notice that? For as far as we know, James and John may very well get the seats at the right and left. All Jesus says is that I don't dish those seats out. So what he does is reminds her and them of the cost of discipleship. You don't understand what you're going to have to go through, is what Jesus said. And the boys say, oh, we do. They found out later. They didn't really realize it then. And then Jesus also tells her, he says, and by the way, that's not my decision. My Father makes those decisions about who will be seated there. But I want us to catch this. I love the spiritual ambition that she has for her sons. The spiritual ambition. So, I've got notes. Let's go, okay? Number one, she prayed, and she's praying because she's talking to the Lord. She prayed that her sons might be a part of the kingdom. I can think of nothing more important for a mother to do than to ensure that you have done everything you can to make sure that your children are a part of the kingdom of God. Moms, dads in this room, listen, I want to ask you something. Is this at the top of your list? Oftentimes it's not, even in the church. People are more interested in how well they do in academia or how well the children are going to be at sports or whether they're going to be successful or whether they're going to make a lot of money or all these things run through our minds. But I'm telling you, number one on your list are your children a part of the kingdom of God. That ought to be a prayer on your lips all the time, all the time. Moms pray, I know, out of necessity because it's just not easy, okay? Moms pray for those kids. It's extremely difficult. I heard about a lady one time, and she called her friend to ask how she was doing, and the phone rang. The friend picked up and said, hello. She says, how is your day going? She said, it is awful. It is terrible. These kids are driving me crazy. They're running around the house. My head is just pounding. I can't get anything done. My back is killing me. My legs are hurting me. My house is a mess. It's just awful. She says, well, honey, listen to me. Why don't you go lay down? I'm coming over right away. I'm going to come over. I'm going to cook dinner for you. I'll make sure the house gets cleaned up. I'll make sure those kids are taken care of. You just go and rest, okay? She says, you're kidding me. She said, no. She says, okay, well, I'm coming right over. But I really call to ask, how is Sam? That mother said, Sam? Who is Sam? And the lady said, oh, my goodness, I've called the wrong number. There was a long pause. She said, are you still coming over? You know, please tell me you're coming over. Moms, you can identify with that, right? You wish somebody would call you sometime. And sometimes it's just difficult. We pray because it's hard. We pray, moms, you pray because there's frustrations, the difficulty of communication. I read about a pastor one time, and he said when he was little, and a similar thing happened to me when I was small, but said he was little. He said he had a toddler, and he finally gave little toddler Steve some responsibilities. He says, son, I need to run into the kitchen just a minute. Watch your sister on the bed. You watch her for me. Will you do that? Yep. So he goes, and he no longer just barely out of the room, and all of a sudden, boom, little Susie. Wah! She's screaming. He says, son, Stevie, I told you to watch her. Did you not watch her? He says, I watched her. I watched her crawl to the end of the bed and fall off and cry. He did exactly what he was supposed to do. Being a parent's not easy, moms. You know that. There's a lot of joy. There's a lot of happiness. There's a lot of sadness. Sometimes they make you so proud you just want to pop a button, and sometimes you just want to pop something else, you know? And then there are times when there's just not enough handkerchiefs in the world. Hang on, Mom. Hang on. I mean, understand the significance of what she wants, her boys to be a part of the kingdom. There's a Jesus question just hangs off sight of this, and there's, what matter is it if you gain the whole world and you lose your soul? Mom, come on. Dad, you can listen today too, okay? What good is it if our children are successful at making money or driving big automobiles or living in the right neighborhood if they don't have salvation? What is there? Being a parent is not easy, but Miss Z gives us a great example here that the first thing on her lips is that I want them to be a part of your kingdom. I want them involved. We need to have the same concern for our children. We need to have the same concern for our grandchildren, for the friends of our church, everybody around us. The heart of every mother and father ought to be that. It ought to be a burden to you that you carry to the throne every single day. You creak open that door yet again today and say, God, bless my children. Save their souls. Save them so they'll understand that they are saved from eternal damnation and they are saved for eternal life. And it means more than just a long time. It means the joy of being with the Lord. So that's the place to begin, and that's where she begins. But she also takes it a step further. She prayed that her sons would be involved in the work of the kingdom. Okay? The work of the kingdom. For us to really enjoy this life, if you're a believer, say, I am. Okay? If you're really to enjoy this life on earth, guess what? It's not enough just to be saved. Our churches are full of people who do nothing but fill pews on a Sunday morning. Now, where our churches also have a lot of people who don't even make it that far, but that's another discussion. But I'm talking about people that are in the church, but they're willing to set back, receive all the blessings, but invest none of the work. Nothing. Where does this spirit of service begin? I tell you where it begins. It begins in the home, Mom. It begins in the home, Dad. It begins there where mothers and fathers show a serving example. They show a working example that I am willing to give time to the Lord's work, that I am willing to give myself to somebody else. That is the model that the Lord left for us, and it is the one that I'm going to live by. Because I got news for you. Nobody else on the planet Earth cares about the souls of your neighbors. Nobody else cares about whether they go to heaven or hell, but you and I have a special place. We are workers in the kingdom. We need to be passing it down and teaching our children. And it's hard to convince our children, okay, to be active in the church. It's like William's mom. She come in there for the third time. Says, William, honey, you have got to get up. You've got to get up. It is time for church. We're going to be late. You just don't lay there. He says, I don't want to go. He says, honey, you have got to get up. No, those people at that church, they make fun of me. They don't like me. And frankly, I don't like them very much. You give me one reason why I should go. She said, well, I'm going to give you two. Okay, William, number one, you're acting like a child and you're 42 years old. And number two, you're the pastor of that church. You need to get up and get going. All right? Miss Z prayed that her boys would be active in the kingdom of God, and we need to walk in her footsteps. But a third thing, and I like this about her, she had big expectations. Oh, friend, listen to me. There is not a parent in here, or you're thinking about you're being a future parent, or you're a grandparent, all of us that don't have these expectations for our children that their future or their life would be this blessing, these great expectations. And I love that hers are spiritual in nature. She didn't just want them to be doorkeepers. She wants them to sit at the right hand and the left hand of God himself. We are to be working in the kingdom. There are no higher positions than those she aspires to set beside the king himself. That is a good thing that she wants her kids there. We may look and say, well, that's awful brash or that's awful presumptuous. I admire boldness to go to the throne and say, God, I would love for my children to be sitting beside you. We have settled for mediocre long enough. In the church, we seem to accept it. We push our kids to excel at sports. We push them to make good grades. We push them to get a good job, and we allow them to cruise through church. We accept mediocrity. Just content with barely making it through the door. Friend, we need to be praying for children to have aspirations of being at the right hand and the left hand of God himself, that I care enough. And that only comes when we put that in them from an early age to become leaders, to mold and fashion people into understanding who God is, to make an interest in teaching about Jesus Christ. Are these anywhere on the list of what we're teaching our children in our homes? She wants them to be laborers in the kingdom, but also to be leaders in the kingdom. Do you remember my little thing I read from Irma Bombeck? That she said, as he was creating it, God says, I am very close to creating something very much like myself. I suppose that's why today is so special when we talk about mothers. It's special because of this close example of God's love. Because when we talk about God's love, it's sacrificial, you know, it's selflessness, all of these things, and they all could be applied to a godly mom. That they're willing to put themselves behind the needs and the love and the care of the family. And a mom who is close to this love understands when God talks to us and says, I will walk with you through the valley of the shadow of death. I will walk with you no matter what life brings you. I will hold your hand. I will pick you up. I will carry you through. It's a mom, but also that's what we say about God, is it not? Mom, what a high calling. What a high calling that you sacrifice over and over and over again. And the best model that could come out of that is for somebody to say, she acts like her Lord. She acts like her Lord. A sacrificial love. Moms, you do it all the time. I heard a preacher had a new family come into church, and he was talking to them, and some little kids there, and he said, well, welcome to the community. Are you enjoying your, you know, moving here in your new house? Little 10-year-old Billy jumped up and says, I do. I finally got my own room. My brother's got his room. My other brother's got his room. My sister got her room. We all have our own rooms. Well, except for Mama. She's still stuck in the room with Daddy, and he snores like crazy. He snores like crazy. So, Mom, you do sacrifice sometimes because you're having to put up with the daddy in the house. But mothers, this is your day. And I encourage you to look at this lady and wonder about yourself. Is this who I am? Is this what I aspire to? But I pray that God bless you today, okay? And I pray for all of us. That if you've ever been here, if there's somebody, you've never experienced the love of God, because I got news for you. It's better than Mama's love, okay? I know that's hard to say, but it's better than Mama's love, because Mama's a sinner. There's some things that you probably already know about her, and I guarantee there's a lot of things you don't know about her. She's a sinner, okay? But the thing is that God's love is greater than that. And if you ever felt like you were in the valley of the shadow of death, I've got the one who truly carries you through death itself. And I would call on you. He grabs you and just says, nothing to be afraid of. I will walk through you through all of this. The one who has already gone through it. So I introduce to you Jesus today. And what a greater day to be saved, to give your life to him than today. When you bring yourself, and he extends his invitation. He's like a mom. Anytime you want to come back home, seems like that door's open. She mumbles to Dad that you're coming. I can't believe that call, but yeah, hey, honey, I know. But God's perfect love, he swings that door open to you and says, come. You are always welcome here. Moms, I love you. I love all the ladies of church that have been my mom, been my sister. And I thank you for all of that. But it is the most important thing today is to receive the love of Christ. You hear me? Let's pray. Father God, I ask you, God, that you touch us today. God, I pray for moms, first of all. God, for the work that they do, it goes unnoticed, and so much of it. But God, that's sort of like you too. Because for a lot of people, Lord, they never, ever give you thanks. There's not a God's Day like we have Mother's Day where they send a card to you. And Lord, they enjoy all of your blessings and everything that you do for them. And Father, I pray today that today is the day that you awaken their soul. And God, that their focus doesn't consume them with themselves. They look up to you and they reach up to you, Lord, where you are always waiting. So, Father, we give you this time. I pray if somebody needs to come or they need to make any decision, that they would do it right now. And God, we give you praise and honor and glory for always being with us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You stand up. We're going to sing, guys.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still. No.
Mom, give her some love, okay? I know you missed breakfast, but you can do something for lunch. All right, so don't forget to sign up, and this other thing that's called the steak supper, so sign up for that, and I have been here a long time, and I hope I'm here a lot longer, all right? That's everything, I think, right? Okay, I'm going to let you dismiss this, okay, Rich?